seeking the lost, yes, kindly entreating wanderers on the mountain astray. Come unto me, his message repeating, words of the Master speaking today.
Going afar
upon the mountain,
bringing the wanderer back again,
into the fold
of my Redeemer,
Jesus the Lamb,
for sinners slain,
seeking the lost and pointing to Jesus, souls that are weak and hearts that are sore, leading them forth in ways of salvation, showing the path to life evermore.
Going afar
upon the mountain,
bringing the wanderer back again,
into the fold
of my Redeemer,
Jesus the Lamb,
for sinners slain.
Thus I would go on missions of mercy, following Christ from day unto day, cheering the faint and raising the fallen, pointing the lost to Jesus the way.
Going afar upon the mountain,
bringing the wanderer back again,
into the fold
of my Redeemer,
Jesus the Lamb,
for sinners slain.
I want to read from the first letter of Peter, chapter 1, beginning at verse 3. 1 Peter, chapter 1, verse 3, including verse 8. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy we have been born anew to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and to an inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold, which though perishable is tested by fire, may redound to praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Without having seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with unutterable and exalted joy. Now there's a word occurs twice in this passage that occurred three times in the passage that Brother Wilson read to us a little while ago, and that's the word rejoice. I want to talk about rejoicing today because I think it's very important that as Christians we should realize the reasons we have for rejoicing. Actually, the words rejoice and rejoicing belong to the same family as joy and joyful. And it may surprise you that they occur about 90 times in the New Testament letters alone. Not to speak of the Revelation and the four Gospels and the Book of Acts, but 90 times in the New Testament letters. And the fact that I think should emerge from a study of these words in the New Testament is that Christians ought to be a joyous people, a people able to rejoice. Now you notice I didn't say a happy people, because I believe that Christians are a happy people, but joy is something more than happiness. Happiness, for example, is your reaction to something nice happening to you. When something pleasant comes into your life and you're happy. For example, I heard somebody say, you look very smart today. Where is he? I can't see him. Yes, I can. You look very smart today. Now, I would think that the natural reaction that David had was to feel happy and pleased. Or if somebody were to say to me, nobody's going to do it, mind you, I've got a present for you this morning, I should feel very happy about it. Because, you see, happiness is dependent on external things. Happiness is your reaction to something happening in your life. Now, joy is something different. Joy is that wonderful disposition, that marvelous quality of life that is not affected by events, that doesn't depend upon a constant stream of nice things happening in our lives. It's an inward tranquility that's unaffected by external things. By the way, it may surprise you that the word happy only occurs in the New Testament, or in the epistles, let me say, four times, the word happy. And you never read the word happiness in the whole of the New Testament. Because the New Testament is concerned much more with something much more important than that rather fleeting, rather transient, up and down experience that we call happiness. It's concerned with joy, with the inner tranquility, the peace that God can give. I want to think about rejoicing today, and I want us to see some of the things in which we as Christians ought to rejoice. For example, rejoice in your faith. What brought you to the service today? I'll tell you what brought you here. Your faith in God brought you here, and your belief in Jesus Christ. Now, have you ever think that sometimes you take your faith for granted? Have you stopped to think about that? You believe in Christ, and perhaps right now you couldn't ever think of yourself being any different from that. You perhaps feel that for you to believe is just as natural as it is, well, as it is for you to be able to see or to be able to hear. But you know, some people can't see and some people can't hear. And sometimes I think we forget that there are people who live in a world of darkness and a world of silence. And we take these blessings for granted. Shut your eyes for just a minute. Go on, shut your eyes for just a minute. And keep them shut till I tell you to open them. Now, I can't stop you hearing. I can't stop you hearing my voice unless I keep quiet. I can't stop you hearing the sound of the birds outside. But at least you can understand what it's like for some poor people who cannot open their eyes as you can now and see. And there are millions of people spiritually today, they simply do not have the vision, the sight that enables them to see spiritual things. They've not heard the sweet voice of Jesus that we sing about, and are living in spiritual darkness. Then you have faith. Now Peter says that in that wonderful passage, 1 Peter chapter 1. He speaks of the preciousness of your faith, more precious than gold, and it is too. He speaks of the one on whom you believe, though you haven't seen him. And you rejoice with a joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. Now he's writing to Christians who are going to put up with persecution. And he says, in spite of these difficulties, rejoice because you have faith. Rejoice because you've come to believe. And you know, when somebody's taken away from you, somebody near and dear to you, or perhaps when somebody close to you is stricken down in some way, or when you're confronted with a personal trial or trouble, at a time like that, I believe the foundation of your life is tested. And it's then, you know, that as a Christian, you're able to thank God that you have a faith to support you. You have somebody to believe in. You have somebody to help you. And I don't think there's anything more tragic in this world than to have to attend the funeral of a man who didn't believe. Or to look on his friends who come to that funeral who don't believe. It's been my lot on various occasions to have sometimes to be present there, and on one or two occasions to conduct a funeral of an unbeliever. Now, I don't promise that fellow that he's going to be raised up to everlasting life. The only thing we can do when an unbeliever dies is to commit his body to the grave as discreetly and as quietly and as respectfully and as reverently as possible. But the despair on those people's faces, to realize that there's nothing to look forward to when that vital spark leaves their body, the thing we called life, there's nothing for them. There's nothing in the future for them. And as a Christian, I'd urge you today to rejoice in your faith. To rejoice that there came a time in your life when you saw your need of Jesus Christ and you took him and you committed your life to him. Be glad that somebody took the time and the trouble and the care to introduce you to the Savior.
Now go back in your memory for just a minute. Do you remember how it happened? Can you remember the first time you came into contact with the gospel of Christ? Or perhaps the first time you came into contact with God's people? In all probability, you didn't just drift into it. Somebody spoke to you. Somebody invited you. Perhaps they even brought you along to the service. And you responded to an invitation. Well, be thankful that that invitation was extended. Be thankful, I say again, that somebody had enough of the love of Jesus in his heart to want to help you to become a Christian. And never forget that there are many, many people today in Corby and in this district who need to have the same service performed for them. Why, you and I, as Peter says, have taken possession of a marvelous treasure, more precious than gold. Hold on to it. Rejoice in it in an unbelieving world where so many have nothing to live for and nothing to die for. And understand that you have a faith that can sustain you through every trial that may come into your life because you belong to Jesus. Rejoice in your faith. Again, rejoice in your hope. And that passage Bill read in Romans chapter 5. Paul speaks there of rejoicing in the hope of the glory of God. And Peter speaks of our rejoicing in a living hope. It's something we possess because of our faith. Those who don't believe in Jesus Christ don't have it. That's why Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 12. Of people who are without God and without hope in the world. Now, I like that expression, rejoicing in the hope of the glory of God, there in Romans chapter 5, because I wish I had the time to deal with it. He's already talked about the glory of God. He's already said in chapter 3, in verse 23, that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Now, what is it we fall short of? Well, he tells us that again in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 2. He speaks of the man being in the image, being the image and the glory of God. You go way back to the beginning, when man was created. He was made in the image of God. He was meant to be like God. And that's a likeness that we've lost because of sin, as he says in Romans 3 and 23. We're not like God, we fall short of the glory of God. But thanks be to him that in Jesus Christ we can attain to the glory of God. We can acquire that likeness to Jesus that makes us like God. And it's a marvelous thought in 2 Corinthians 3 and verse 18 that the Christians experience day by day. We all, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory. That's the daily transformation that can take place in your life. And you can rejoice, but the word rejoice in this particular passage means we can boast about, we can speak with pride of the fact that we're going to be transformed into the likeness of Jesus, that one day we'll see him as he is and be like him. Now, since that's true, since you've got that kind of hope, how can a Christian ever be miserable? Ever really be unhappy? On Thursday night, the young Christians were dealing with Psalm 139. And three of the things that came out of that passage, the omnipotence of God, the omniscience of God, and the omnipresence of God, the fact that God is all-knowing, the fact that God is everywhere present, and the fact that God is all-powerful. And most of the young people came to the conclusion that what that psalm does for you initially is to fill you with a sense of your own littleness before him and your own limitation. But on the other hand, you see the limitlessness of God. And that's what consoled us in our study. It's what ought to console every one of us here today. The knowledge that because we are Christians, we have a great and a mighty God who inhabits eternity. And he's our Father. Now, we say we believe in a loving Father, don't we? We say that the flowers are his. We say the young lion is his. The birds are his. We say the very hairs of our head are all counted. We say that he knows our down sittings and our uprisings. We say that he knows every thought in our minds altogether. There's not a word in our lips, but he knows that too. We say that there's nowhere that we can be that he is not. Well, if we say all this and we sing all this, you know. But I maintain that if we believed it with all our hearts, we'd rejoice in the Lord and rejoice in him always. It's what the Bible teaches. after all, is it nothing that the Christian God's arms are around you to support you? Is it nothing that God promises that no weapon formed against you shall ever prosper? Is it nothing that, as Jesus says, your Heavenly Father knows what things you have need of before you ask Him? Is it nothing to know that you have an inheritance, incorruptible and undefiled, reserved in heaven? Nobody can touch it. And that you're kept through Jesus Christ? This is a marvelous thing. Every Christian ought to be able to say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man can do unto me. And with that kind of assurance, we ought to be able to rejoice in the Lord. Rejoice in your hope. And another thing, it was in the passage Bill mentioned, rejoice in tribulation. Now, here again you might say, well, rejoice in your faith, rejoice in your hope, that's rational, that's reasonable, that's possible. But rejoice in tribulation, or tribulations, it's plural here. Rejoice when you're being put through the mill. That sounds a bit of an exaggeration, doesn't it? It sounds like asking a bit too much. And actually, that word tribulations is an interesting word. It's a word that describes the fellow there with his bare feet and he's trampling the grapes. Crushing them, pulping them, squeezing out the juice. Actually, I'll tell you something. Do you know what the word onomatopoeia means? Onomatopoeia is the word that you use to describe a word that itself conveys almost a sound. Like, for example, I say, plop. Now, the word plop is an onomatopoeic word because it conveys the very sound itself, doesn't it? And they even think that in the Greek, this word that's used here to describe tribulations is an onomatopoeic word. It describes the actual sound of the man pressing, squeezing out the grapes, because it's flipsis. You can almost see the juice squeezing out. Flipsis. That's the word. And that's what it means. It means pressure. It means crushing. Rejoice in your pressure. Rejoice in your crushing. Or again, if you want the English word tribulation, it comes from tribulum. And it's the Latin word this time. And the tribulum was like a platform with spikes underneath. A heavy platform with spikes underneath it. Or maybe sharp bits of flint. And that was used for threshing. They had an oxen to drag that thing backwards and forwards across the corn or the wheat. To press, to break the grains so that the kernel was separated from the husk. The pressure did it. And that's what it means. Pressure, beatings, threshings, tribulations. Now, Paul doesn't say we endure tribulations. He doesn't say we put up with tribulations. He says we rejoice in tribulations. And you say, well, how is it possible? Well, it's only possible if you understand what he also says in that passage, knowing that pressure produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint. Now, if your understanding of the purpose that is served by tribulations is right, then you'll be able to accept tribulations with joy. Certainly some people become bitter and desperate when trouble comes into their life. It's because they have no hope and they see no reason to it. They see nothing beyond it. It doesn't lead to anything in their life, this tribulation. But when you're able to look forward with confidence and know that there's something behind it, your power to bear the pressure increases tremendously, especially because you know that you're living in a world where your Heavenly Father is King. And there's not a thing against you, but everything's for you. And remember too, there's another reason why God allows us to put up with tribulations or threshings. Our life isn't a series of accidents. Do you believe that? I do. I'm not the victim of blind chance. I'll tell you something. Chance is not a Christian's word. Chance doesn't exist for a Christian. Chance is the gambler's word. Chance is the word of the man who doesn't believe in God. He believes in chance. And if you trust a chance, you don't trust a God. And if you trust to God, there's no chance in it. Because the scriptures teach us that our sufferings are designed to produce endurance, and endurance produces character. Now realize this. Think about it. When your plans don't seem to be working out, when things are not going as sweetly as you thought they were going to go, when all the opposition is raised against you, you get resistance. Understand that resistance is designed to strengthen your character and make you a better person. Now, if you can accept that fact, and if you can believe that you're going to come out of this not only a better person, but with something to show for it, you can accept and rejoice in tribulation. And of course, there's another point too, and with this I will conclude here, on this point anyway. We'll be helped to understand the significance of tribulation and why we can rejoice in tribulation when we understand that our own sufferings create within us the capacity for helping other people in their tribulation. That's what Paul says. He says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, the Father of all comfort, who comforts us in our tribulation, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in tribulation with the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. You pass it on. In your tribulation, God comforts you. And don't forget the root meaning of the word comfort. It's fortis. And don't forget that fortis means courage. God gives you courage. And because God gives you courage, you're able to give courage to somebody else who needs it. You're able to strengthen others in tribulation. That's what the Bible says, and it's what experience proves. Do you now and then feel the pressure? Do you now and then feel that you're being put through the mill? Well, I'll tell you what you do. You go to somebody who's being put through the mill all the time. Talk to that person. And you'll prove that God gives comfort in tribulation. And you'll be helped. Well, Jesus says, doesn't he? Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. There's a reason to it, you see. We're talking about martyrs now, and sometimes we think that the martyrs are the ones who shed their blood to seal their testimony. That's not the case. They're not martyrs because they died. They were martyrs before they died. They were witnesses before they died. They simply shed their blood to seal their testimony. And I'll tell you another point too. It's often a lot easier to die for your faith than to live for it. Believe me, that's true. A lot easier to die for your faith than to live for it. And if you're being given a hard time at work because of your faith, or if you're being made the object of fun or ridicule at school because of your faith, or even if in your own home you find members of your own family are unsympathetic because of your faith, rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. Now, I know that to live for your faith and the ordinary humdrum round of daily life is often harder than to die for it. But let me remind you of the words of this man, Paul, who did both, in fact. He lived for his faith and he died for it. He says, our light affliction, which is but for a moment, works for us a more exceeding weight of eternal glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the unseen. For the things which are seen are transient or temporal. The things which are unseen are eternal. So rejoice in your faith, rejoice in your hope, rejoice in your trials. And one last point that I can't miss. Rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Jesus said that, didn't he? Here come the disciples back. They've been out, you know, and great things have happened. Lord, even the devils were subjected to us. We cast out devils in your name. And Jesus says, don't rejoice because the devils were subject to you, but rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Did you see the Jubilee Honours List? You didn't see my name on it, did you? No, I didn't see it either. It wasn't on it. It wasn't on the one before that either. It's not likely to be on the next one. I'm not expecting it anyway. But you see, each year hundreds of people get decorations or awards or titles or medals or one thing or another, and there's no doubt lots of others would like to receive them. And some have set their eyes on a title. They want to see their name in Burke's peerage or have their name on the honours list. By the way, I saw in the newspaper the other day, maybe you saw it too, there's a black ruler out in Africa who's just about to have himself crowned as emperor. He's having a golden throne made in France. And he has to have his jackets made extra long to wear all the medals and the badges. And it's absolutely true that he wears on both sides of his jackets. And one eagle-eyed photographer spotted that one of those medals was a skiing medal that had been awarded by a ski resort in Switzerland. Evidently gave the man pleasure to display all these medals. I gave myself a sense of importance and satisfaction. Well, Buckingham Palace may never give the nod in your direction. And, you know, you may never catch the attention of the people who walk in high places. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Rejoice because your names are written in heaven. That's the one recognition that matters. Paul says, I like this passage in Philippians 4 and 3. He gives a list of the names of his co-workers, and he says, there are the others too. There are the rest of my fellow workers. He says, in effect, I'm not going to mention their names, but they're the rest of my fellow workers whose names are written in the book of life. They're not in my letter, Paul says, but they're written up there. They're written in heaven. They're in the Lamb's book of life, or the book of the life of the Lamb, as it's called. That's important, isn't it? Thank God that when you became a Christian, your name was written in heaven. I'm not suggesting that God needs a book to remind you, or to remind him anyway. God never forgets a name and address. God knows where you live. He never forgets a name and address, and he doesn't need a book to remind him. But it simply means that God has taken note of you, that God knows you, and that God recognizes you, and that God acknowledges you, and God receives you. Jesus says, rejoice in knowing this, in find joy in the knowledge that God knows all about you. Thank God that you have a God who won't forget you. And this morning, as we bring this worship service to a close, let's really go home rejoicing. Rejoicing in our faith, that we have a faith in an unbelieving world. Rejoicing in our hope that we have a hope. Rejoicing that we may be permitted to suffer for him, that Christ likeness may be developed in us, and rejoicing that our names are written in heaven, and that one day we shall be with that great multitude in the heavenly city, the new Jerusalem, the city of the Lamb, with the church of the firstborn whose names are written in heaven, and we shall come to the one whose blood speaks of better things than the blood of Abel. You have a lot to be thankful for, a lot to give you the cause for real joy. Accept it. Live in the light of your faith and understand the blessings that are yours because Jesus came into your life. Now we're going to sing number.
Since the love of God has shed priceless blessings on my head, I have made it my own. I will hide it in my heart that it never may depart. It shall rule there alone. The love of God within the heart will kindliness and warmth impart. The soul will glow like Jesus in his tender mercy. If the heart is made his dwelling place, the love of God glows like a flame. Through endless years, it is the same. The love of God will never fail nor lose its glory till we see him face to face. Since the Son of God came down with his love our lives to crown, he with us would remain. Greater love there could not be. Jesus died for you and me. In our hearts he would reign. The love of God within the heart will kindliness and warmth impart. part, the soul will glow like Jesus in his tender mercy. If the heart is made
his dwelling place, the love of God
flows like a flame.
Through endless years,
it is the same. The love of God will never fail nor lose its glory till we see him face to face. He who gave his love to me that I might from sin be free
bids me share it today.
As I love you, he has said, you must serve men in my stead
as you go
on your way.
The love of God
within the heart
will kindliness and warmth impart.
The soul will glow like Jesus in his tender mercy. If the heart is made his dwelling place,
the love of God
flows like a flame.
Through endless years,
it is the same. The love of God will never fail nor lose its glory till we see him face to face. While his love burns true and bright, we are walking in the light.
He has shown us the road.
We his glory must reflect, lest our dimness and neglect
keep some soul
from its God.
The love of God
within the heart
will kindliness and warmth impart.
The soul will glow like Jesus in his tender mercy. If the heart is made his dwelling place,
the love of God
flows like a flame.
Through endless years,
it is the same. The love of God will never fail nor lose its glory till we see him face to face. My shepherd I'll not want. He makes me down to lie in pastures green. He leadeth me in pastures green. He leadeth me the quiet waters by. Soul he doth restore again, and me to walk doth make. Within the paths of righteousness, within the paths of righteousness, in for his own name's sake. Yea, though I walk in death's dark veil, yet will I fear none ill. For thou art with me and thy rod, for thou art with staff me comfort still. My table thou hast furnished in presence of my foes.
My head thou dost with oil anoint.
My head thou dost with oil anoint, and my cup overflows. Goodness and mercy all my life shall surely follow me.
And in God's house forevermore,
and in God's house forevermore, my dwelling place shall be.